cold northern sky, but the wind that bears them becomes an icy, blinding glare. So too the gleaming polished weaponry, the helmet, shields, spears, and plated corselets, all the bronze paraphernalia of war that issued from the ships. The rising glare reflected off the coppery sky, and the land beneath laughed under the arcing metallic glow. A deep bass thrumming rose from the marching feet. And, like a bronze bolt in the center, Achilles, who now began to arm. His eyes glowed like white-hot steel, and he gritted his teeth against the grief that had sunk into his bones. And every motion he made in putting on the armor forged for him in heaven was an act of passion directed against the Trojans. Clasping on his shins the greaves trimmed in silver at the ankles, strapping the corselet onto his chest, slinging the silver-studded bronze sword around a shoulder, and then lifting the massive heavy shield that spilled light around it as if it were the moon. War. A fire that has flared up in a lonely settlement high in the hills of an island, reflecting light on the faces of men who have put out to sea and must watch helplessly as rising winds bear them away from their dear ones. So too the terrible beauty of Achilles' shield, a fire in the sky. He lifted the helmet and placed it on his head, and it shone like a star, with the golden horsehair Hephaestus had set thickly on the crest, rippling in waves. He tested the fit and flex of the armor, splinting on the sand, and found that the metal lifted him like wings. He pulled from its case his father's spear, the massive heavy spear that only Achilles could handle, made of Pelian ash, which the centaur Chiron had brought down from Mount Pelion and given to Achilles' father to be the death of heroes. Automaton and Alcinous harnessed the horses, cinched the leather straps, fit the bits in their jaws, and drew the reins back into the jointed chariot. Automaton picked up the bright lash and jumped into the car, and behind him Achilles stepped in, shining in his war gear like an amber sun, and in a cold voice he cried to his father's horses, "Xanthus and Malleus, Podarges' famous colts, see that you bring your charioteer back safe this time when we have had enough of war, and not leave him for dead as you left Patroclus." And from beneath the yoke, Xanthus spoke back, hooves shimmering, his head bowed so low that his mane swept the ground, as Hera, the white-armed goddess, gave him a voice. "This time we will save you, mighty Achilles. This time, but your hour is near. We are not to blame, but a great god and strong fate. Nor was it slowness or slackness on our part that allowed the Trojans to despoil Patroclus. No, the best of gods, fair-haired Leto's son, killed him in the front lines and gave Hector the glory. As for us, we could outrun the west wind, which men say is the swiftest, but it is your destiny to be overpowered by a mortal and a god." Xanthus said this, then the Furies stopped his voice, and Achilles, greatly troubled, answered him, "I don't need you to prophesy my death, Xanthus. I know in my bones I will die here far from my father and mother. Still, I won't stop until I have made the Trojans sick of war." And with a cry, he drove his horses to the front. So that's the end of book 19. Then throughout 20, 21, and 22, he's berserk. Singing the story of Troy. And this was his song. He's just finished. And Odysseus went. Tears welled up in his eyes and flowed down his cheeks. And then an italicized passage, which is a simile, an extended comparison. So Odysseus' weeping is going to be compared to something, and this is the comparison. He wept as a woman wails and she throws herself upon her husband's body. He has fallen in battle before the town walls, fighting to the last to defend his city and protect his children. As she sees him dying and gasping for breath, she clings to him and shrieks, while behind her, soldiers prod their spears into her shoulders and back. And as they lead her away into slavery, her tear-drenched face is a mask of pain. So to Odysseus, pitiful in his grief. Now this is a remarkable simile. Odysseus's weeping is compared to the weeping of a woman whose husband has just died. She throws herself on his body. Meanwhile, soldiers are prodding her with the spears. They're moving along. They want her to go to the ships and lead her away into captivity. So the poet doesn't say explicitly, but artistically represents Odysseus remembering a scene such as that. Maybe he was a soldier prodding a woman in the back whose husband maybe he has just killed, just as Achilles in the speech that I read, fighting men for their wives. And so he's hearing the story of Troy, he's weeping, and he has this flash of memory, it seems. And it's, in a sense, nothing terrible happened to him. He won the battle. He was victorious. He's leading this beautiful woman off, captivity. He'll probably sell her for, some sort of price. But Odysseus' experience is never, the experience Odysseus has here is never represented directly in the Iliad. But Homer, through his art, and the simile is a standard part of his art. The Iliad has over 200 similes, the Odyssey over 100. Leads us into the deep psychology at play here. So this is, I think, a recognition, and I'm pretty sure Shay talks about this, although I don't remember explicitly, because I haven't read Odysseus in America for a long time, of PST, and that's what's happening to Odysseus at this moment. But it is at the same time an example of communalization of grief. Although the audience, the general audience, the Phaeacians, have never even experienced combat, Odysseus is a combat veteran, and he is in a setting where he can relive this in an unthreatening, communal setting. So I wanted to call your attention to that in the Odyssey.